welcome to another of the Center for Economic Policy Research's video podcasts on the fast-moving impact of COVID-19. My name is Tim Phillips. For many weeks, Italy was at the center of the COVID-19 pandemic. We all saw the images of empty streets and piazzas, but we also saw images of overwhelmed hospitals and desperate medical staff. And that raises two questions. Why was mortality in some regions unexpectedly high? And can Italy's welfare system compensate those who have survived COVID-19 but lost their earnings due to the lockdown? Both questions are, of course, very relevant to other countries that are coping with COVID-19 at the moment. Today, I'm joined by Carlo Fabero of Bocconi University, whose paper in issue 4 of COVID Economics examined the causes of Lombardy's high mortality rate, and also Francesco Figari of the University of Insubria, whose paper, co-authored with Carlo Fiorio in issue 8 of COVID Economics, offers a scenario of the impact of fiscal relief for Italian households. So Carlo and Francesco, welcome to Vox Talks.
Hello, nice to be here.
Hello.
First of all, your universities are both in northern Italy, right at the epicenter of this. What was your experience of the crisis? Carlo, you first.
My experience, I mean, to be honest, is very personal because I got interest in epidemiological model because my daughter is a young doctor and her first job was in a department that was immediately transformed to deal with COVID patients. And she was telling me this terrible stories of hospital overwhelms and very high mortality. And so that prompted me to go back to the basic model and to understand if the basic model could explain this burst of mortality and this hospital overwhelming that we had in Lombardy. And I discovered that that was not the case. And so I start working on the model capable of explaining the very high mortality that you observe when the health system is overwhelmed.
Francesco, what's your personal experience of the crisis in northern Italy?
As others, my university has been closed at the beginning of March. And since then, we have transformed completely our activities through lectures, exams, graduations, everything online. We miss our usual academic life, of course, but I would like to say that we have found some new dimensions in the relation with the students. And we also found a new interest of the students for topics related to public expenditures, taxation, tax compliance in a country like Italy. So the crisis emphasizes and gives new lights to the public sector intervention in the economy. And I think this is something that the students are particularly interested in this period.
Carlo, as you say, your paper is a response to the failure of the general model to predict the mortality that you personally experienced. Tell us more about that.
So let me just put everything in context. Lombardy has been severely hit by COVID-19. In Lombardy, there is a population of 10 million inhabitants. There were about 81,000 total cases at the end of last week and around 15,000 fatalities. Now, so one striking aspect of COVID-19 in Lombardy is the very high fatality rate. In general, when we use model to simulate policy and to recommend policy. But one very important aspect of models before using them to simulate policy is their capability of replicating the observed data. So having a realistic model, I think it's very important for making sensible policy advice. If you take the standard epidemiological model of virus diffusion and you apply to Lombardy, you see that this model cannot replicate the observed data in Lombardy. I concentrate on understanding which was the most striking missing aspect that once you add it to the model, you make the model capable of replicating the observed mortality. And the data told me that adding an endogenous component of mortality, which is related to hospital congestion and can be measured by assessed demand for intensive care units beds, improved greatly the capability of the model to replicate the observed data and the high mortality. You see two lines. The red line is the fatality rate observed in Italy. So it's the ratio of fatalities to total identified cases in Lombardy. There is this big blue spike here. This is where the date of the lockdown in Lombardy, the 8th of March. And you can see that mortality went up and it stabilized around the level just below 20%. Now, if you take the standard epidemiological model, which is the acronym SEER, and you make the standard hypothesis of the crude fatality rate of the disease, hypothesis that you get from data from other countries, in particular from the Chinese experience, you have that the crude fatality rate of 1.38% produces a pattern of fatality, which is the black line, which you can see is way below the observed data. This is the question on which the paper focuses. If you want to have a realistic model, you have to think about some way in which the model generated data should move from the black line to the red line. And here is my reading of the basic model and the intuition on the part that I have added on. So in standard model, the lethality rate is an exogenous biological property of the virus, okay? You have two cases. The case A, in which the net reproduction number, which is the number of individual that an infected individual makes infected himself, so it's the rate at which the contagious it's spread, the net reproduction number is less than one, then the virus diffusion is inhibited and mortality goes to zero. If the net reproduction number becomes larger than one, then mortality converges to an exogenous given crude fatality rate. What happens that in the data, there might be an endogenous component of mortality. So there are some patients that are severely hit by the virus. Of course, they can either survive or not survive. That will depend on the quality of care they can be offered, right? If they need the intensive care unit hospitalization, and there is no intensive care unit hospitalization available, they would die even if they could have survived given availability of ICU beds. This is the flow chart of the standard model, right? Individual move from different compartment, okay? At the beginning, they are susceptible. Then they become espoused. Then they become infected. So the time between they are espoused and infected is the incubation time. Then once they are infected, they are divided into groups. Either they recover or they become fatalities. And of course, the fact that you belong to one group or the other, it depends on the probability that defines the mortality of the virus. But once you get on one of the two paths, that's it. You are done. There is no reversibility. This is a very simplistic view of the virus diffusion that does not take into account what an economist would call excess demand for hospitalization and intensive care beds. So here is the flowchart of my modified model. So again, we have individuals at the beginning are susceptible, then become espoused, then become infectious. When they're infectious, they can go down three paths. Either they have the mild infection, the so-called asymptomatic. Those mild, they recover after some period. They can have a serious symptomatic infection. And in this case, they fall into groups, those who are doomed to become fatalities, and the severe cases. The severe cases, they go into the hospital. Also, the fatal go into the hospital, but the hospital cannot do much for them. So the fatal, they go to the hospital. Some of them go to intensive care, but from intensive care, they do not survive. For the severe, there are two scenarios. Either some of them do not need intensive care and then heal normally. But for those who need intensive care, there are two scenarios. Either they find intensive care availability. After having found intensive care availability, they recover. Or they are bounced out of intensive care because there are not enough beds for them. And in this case, they become fatalities, even if they could have been cured in the case of availability of intensive care beds. That is the idea. So here you have the data from Italy. So these are the daily fatalities in Italy. It's the continuous black line with dots. And then you have two lines. The blue line is the model predicted fatalities where you do not take into account the intensive care constraint. The other one is a red line, which is the fatality that the model will predict when, given the availability of ICU beds, of intensive care unit beds, if the number of patients is higher than the available beds, this generates further mortality. And you can see that the model with this new feature is capable of replicating very well the unfortunate data set that we have available in Lombardy. That is the main message of my paper. The inclusion of an endogenous component of mortality is an important feature to be included in realistic model for the simulation of the COVID-19 diffusions under different policy regimes. This paper has not yet built the model that you need to simulate policy, but is a first step towards it. And I'm now working on constructing a realistic model together with Andrea Ichino and Aldo Rustichini, with whom I'm co-authoring another paper. And the second point is that hospital congestion is an important determinant of the endogenous component of mortality. Of course, this endogenous component of mortality might be affected also by other factors, for example, progress of the medicine and success of specific cures that might be found. And so the idea of having an endogenous component of mortality in a model to simulate the diffusion of the virus seems to me as being a very important feature.
Thank you, Carlo. Now, are there wider policy implications, do you think, from recognizing how important this endogenous component is?
Right. So in order to assess the optimal, let's say, phase two policies, I think one has to add feature to this model, right? So, of course, one of the most important feature is to have a model capable of dealing with the trade-off between saving life and going into a deep recession. So you need an economic part of the model. Also, because we see that mortality, it's very diversified through age groups, you need to have an heterogeneous agent model in which you have agents belonging to different categories. Different categories, of course, are certainly age-related, as mortality is very different across ages, but also you can think about the specific sector of the economy being different because the degree of proximity that you have between workers in different sectors is very different, and therefore the diffusion of the virus is different among different sectors. Think, for example, as agriculture, as health, as the two extreme cases in terms of distancing and between workers and in terms of danger in the working environment. So you need to have a model which is much more articulated than this one to address the question of the optimal lockdown policy. But in addressing the question of the optimal lockdown policy, you have one of the main messages of this model is that you have to take into account the importance of controlling hospitalization to avoid to generate the so-called second wave, which of course could be very serious if we have again our intensive care units overwhelmed as we did at the beginning of March before the lockdown started to solving this problem. Just to give you an idea, when the lockdown was introduced, all the intensive unit care in Lombardy were at full capacity. Now the capacity has been brought down to below 50% thanks to two factors. First, the reduction of hospitalization, and second, a tremendous effort in increasing the number of ICU beds available that has been performed by the authorities.
It's true, and it's one of the things that we've seen across Europe is that effort to rapidly increase ICU capacity so that we don't hit this constraint that you've modelled here. Carlo, thank you very much for that. Francesco, you've described your paper as a stress test of Italy's benefit system. What does this mean?
Well, the stress test approach is something common in financial institutions to test the sensitivity of a portfolio to a set of extreme but still plausible shocks and to assess the significance of the system vulnerabilities. Basically, we follow Tony Atkinson's suggestion of extending the same approach, so the stress test approach, to tax benefit systems. in order to predict the cushioning effects of the social protection schemes in the event of a loss of market incomes and to assess the overall income stabilization after a macroeconomic shock. A stress test exercise then can provide evidence of the effects of either an hypothetical macroeconomic shocks on household incomes or the effects of a contemporary shocks for which data are not available yet. We follow the second approach. So we apply a stress test approach on a contemporary shock. And so we simulate counterfactual scenarios using a micro simulation approach with three key ingredients: the earning losses due to the economic shutdown at the very beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic in Italy, the tax benefit system in place, including the different automatic stabilizers already in place in the Italian tax benefit system, and then the new discretionary policies implemented by the government. So the main idea, the primary aim of our paper is to offer really a scenario rather than a nowcast or a forecast for the future in order to understand in a timely fashion the extent to which the Italian tax benefit system provides an income stabilization at the beginning, at the onset of the health emergency for those who lost their earnings due to the lockdown and the shutdown of economic activities. So first we attempt to identify the workers affected by the lockdown using aggregate data on employment shares by activity sectors, because in Italy, somehow different from other countries, at some point government decided which economic activity sectors were to close. And this was in the second half of March. So we identified the workers were in those sectors. And second, we estimate the household incomes for those individuals who lost their earnings, considering the cushioning effect of the tax benefit system and the new policies that in the same time the government decided to implement. And doing this stress test exercise, basically we are able to see the first order effects of the first month of the pandemic. In this graph, basically you see which is the impact on market incomes with the blue bar and disposable income, the red bar. Taking the overall population, we can estimate a loss of market incomes of around 30%. And here, basically, we are talking about market incomes of around 10 million workers, representing around 40% of workers. This loss in market income is higher at the bottom of the distribution, in the quintile groups of the poorest individuals, where basically most of individuals or a larger share of individuals live in a one-earner family, and where the loss of that income source represent the loss of their main income. The gradient is inverted, so has a different trend if we look at the disposable income. So the disposable income, including then the benefits that the families are able to receive in this period. And if you look at the disposable income, the red bars, it's quite clear that in relative terms, the richest individuals lose more than the poorest. And this is already a first sign of the intervention of the government. To put some absolute numbers behind this graph, we can say that in just 1 month, the first month of the shutdown, we register a loss in market income, original income, of around 20 billion euros, which is more than 1 percentage point of gross domestic product. And even if the government implemented the new policies, in particular new schemes of wage supplementation and a new transfer, lump sum transfers to self-employed individuals, so all these transfers amount at around 8 billion euros, the difference, the negative difference in the disposable income is around 8 billion euros. So there is a quite huge and important loss in market incomes and disposable income, somehow compensated by the public sector intervention. So there is a huge amount of public money going into the economy, and of course a huge amount of money that the government is losing in terms of lost tax revenue and lost social contributions. And this will have an impact on public debt of our country. This is because the government implemented some measure, as I already mentioned, the wage supplementation schemes in particular, and the lump sum transfers. And these schemes are useful and needed in order to compensate the loss of market income for those who have been affected by the shutdown. If we want to have a measure then of the compensation offered by the public sector intervention, one way is to look at the level of income post-shock, so after the shutdown, relative to the level of income that we could observe before the shock. And this this measure is what is known in the literature as replacement income. On average, the replacement income in this first month of COVID-19 pandemic in Italy is about 80%. But of course, as expected, but something important to have always in mind is basically for some families, in particular the richest one, the largest component of this replacement income is represented by earnings, so market incomes of other family members. So when there is more than one individual working in a family, that is an insurance way for the whole families. The poorest families, where it's more likely that only one individual has income sources, earnings, then the situation becomes immediately more difficult. But these families are also those who have received, in relative terms, more transfers from the government. And then if we focus indeed on the transfers received, we learn something more on the policies implemented. Because basically in Italy, we know that the wage supplementation schemes, for instance, offer a replacement of 80%, up to 80% of previous earning. And one could think that for a short period of time, 80% of previous earnings could be enough to live with. But as soon as we look a bit more at the details, we understand that the real replacement rate is much lower because there are many details in the policy. There is a cap that basically implies that the replacement rate is much lower. And this is what we can see computing the compensation rate. These indicators tell us the extent to which an earning loss is indeed compensated by the public sector intervention, by transfers, net of taxes provided by the government. And so you see that that number that previously was 80% now goes down and is on average lower than 60%. And the two major components of this compensation rate are represented by the wage supplementation benefits that in particular is received by the employees. And so this is received by individuals in the middle of the income distribution. And the lump sum transfer that the government introduced, it is a lump sum of 600 euros per month that all basically self-employed can receive. And these offer an important compensation, in particular for those in the first quintile groups, so the poorest individuals that do not have other forms of compensation. So there has been quite an effort from the government at the beginning of the pandemic. In aggregate terms, basically, this effort represent 1 percentage point of gross domestic product, which is an important size, an important amount of resources, still much less than other European countries and definitely lower than the average of European countries. One important question is what happens to the absolute resilience of our welfare state. So to what extent our welfare state, our tax benefit system, is capable to prevent people from falling into a poverty situation, so for falling into a risk of poverty. And we do have some number on this as well. And it's quite well known that in Italy, the level of people or individual at the poverty risk, using the European terminology, is relatively high. So if we look at the overall population before crisis, we had around 19% of individuals at the risk of poverty. This percentage goes up to 23% if we just focus on children. What happens with the crisis? So what happens with the shutdown when individuals lose their earnings without compensation policies? This is, of course, an hypothetical scenario, but what would have happened without compensation policies? Well, the overall poverty risk basically would have doubled, up to 38% for the overall population. And so in this sense, we can see the effect of the compensation policies, of the support provided by the government that allows to have a poverty risk around 27%. So there is a quite huge increase in the poverty risk, 8 percentage points, of course, much less than what we would have observed without this public sector intervention. The poverty risk for children, which is somehow a category that hasn't received too much attention in this period in Italy, as all schools have been closed and there are no alternative activities and there is no real support for families with children, we also see that the poverty risk increased a lot, more than 13 percentage points.
Thank you very much, Francesco, for that. This sort of analysis that you've done here, this sort of stress test, you could possibly do this for other countries, couldn't you? Is that something you're going to attempt, or is that something you know that other people are attempting?
Yes, there are other experiences in other countries. Some papers are already out. Together with Carlo Fiorio, we are currently working on a comparative paper, including the largest economies in Europe. So in addition to Italy, Germany, France, Spain, UK, and Belgium as well, given that is a country affected severely from the pandemic. And using Euromod, the EU-wide tax benefit micro-simulation model, we want to provide these sort of estimates in a timely way comparing different countries. And we think that this is particularly interesting because depending on the scenarios analyzed, one can then try to disentangle the effects of the different lockdown measures that we know are different across countries. Also, depending on the severity of the pandemic, then the effects of the existing tax benefit system, and then the effect of the new discretionary measures introduced by the government. So this is something on which we are working, and we hope to have some results soon.
Without giving away your results, do you have any intuition yet about how well Italy has done in these welfare measures?
As I mentioned at the beginning of the pandemic, when the government decided to shut down some economic sectors, this decision has been accompanied by some policy measures, some of which were quite well designed. Others suffered from bureaucratic problems. So there has been quite a lot of delay for people receiving this support from the states. And the major problem we experienced is that the existing instrument in the tax benefit system in Italy were not ready to react in an automatic way to such a crisis. So we have experienced basically that the automatic stabilizers of the Italian tax benefit system did not provide any support or very limited support to people. So we had to wait for discretionary measures. And this is something that we are experiencing now that basically we are at the end of the second month of lockdown. So after the first month where we have experienced some measures, the one that we described in our paper, then another month basically flied without any intervention. And yesterday, the Italian government issued a new decree law put almost 55 billions euro to finance new policies, to finance new ways to support peoples, including a new safety net, a new emergency income that should prevent millions of people to get in a poverty status.
Both of your papers focus in a way on how Italy had to lead in responding to the crisis and how well it did. Are there lessons now that policymakers elsewhere can take from Italy's experience, both good and bad? Carlo, what do you think?
I think that if I look at the way in which the diffusion of the virus has been managed, Italy did very well in terms of the shock reaction. But in terms of the scheduled reaction, something could have been done really better. And what I'm thinking of is in particular having a testing strategy for either serological tests or swabs to increase the number of people tested, especially for the phase two of the policy, is something that puzzles me. Every model tells you that you should increase the testing because the true problem at the moment are the asymptomatic cases, right? Because they make a difference for the diffusion of the virus, right? I believe that our health authorities have reacted well under the emergency and have been very good in increasing over a very short horizon the potential of the supply of hospitals and in particular of intensive care units. But in terms of a more long-term strategy, I think that the lack of testing is what really I find puzzling.
And Francesco, for you.
I think it will be really important to understand how well suited the existing institutional arrangements are in different countries, Italy included, for compensating the income loss during the pandemic. Such evidence will raise normative issues on the protection level that the tax benefit system should guarantee to the population. And this will back up the idea that unconditional basic income instruments would have made comprehensive compensation possible during the pandemic without the need of discretionary and temporary policies, which are, of course, really important and are needed in order to prevent the negative and adverse effects of such a pandemic.
The two papers we have been discussing are Why is COVID-19 Mortality in Lombardy So High? Evidence from the Simulation of a CEIHCR Model. That's Carlo Favero, and you'll find it in issue 4 of COVID Economics. And the other one is Welfare Resilience in the Immediate Aftermath of the COVID-19 Outbreak in Italy. Authors are Francesco Figari and Carlo Fiorio. That's in issue 8. Both, of course, are free downloads at voxeu.org. Keep in touch with the COVID-19 coverage at VoxEU. We're adding to it every day with articles, podcasts, videos, and webinars. And so from Carlo, Francesco, and myself, and everyone at the CEPR, goodbye for now, and stay positive by staying negative.